looking at advances in breast cancer surgery, and as Garvit has already taken you through the history of breast cancer, that how we have really moved from radical mastectomy to breast conservation surgery with oncoplasty, trying to maintain cost as well as survival. So the goal, and the first and foremost goal for us, has always been survival. That should not be compromised in any case. And then, of course, reducing the risk of local recurrence, and cosmesis is an important outcome for the patient, but that always remains last, but not the least, I would say. And as we've seen the history already, that Halstead's concept and Fisher's concept and all of those concepts in breast cancer surgery, today we have is a combination of a lot of those theories. And then we have the multidisciplinary approach, where chemotherapy and radiation does help our surgical efforts in bringing up the survival. So breast conservation, as we have already seen, is now the accepted norm in surgery for breast cancer. We have the B06 trial, which tells you that there was no difference in survival outcomes as long as radiation was combined with breast conservation surgery. Radiation therapy forms a very important part of breast conservation surgery. And there have been other trials also other than NSAP B06, and all of them have essentially told us that it is safe to do breast conservation surgery, provided the indications are right. And Garvit has already told you the contraindications that could be considered. The patient may have a mastectomy instead. So there's a lot being discussed about oncoplastic breast surgery since 1990. This concept was introduced and the rest of the world is following it routinely. We in India have also started in last 10 years doing this and trying to improve our cosmesis. This is basically, essentially, we are maintaining sound oncological principles and there is no alternative to that. However, we could apply some plastic surgical principles and get the breast to modulate aesthetically and provide an acceptable cosmesis that would improve our cosmetic outcome, and it's helpful for the patient's psychosocial rehabilitation, a healthy body image, and hence a better quality of life. So it is no longer acceptable to have deformities after breast conservation surgery. So we have a lot in our armamentarium for breast reconstruction. There is partial, and if the patient requires mastectomy, then whole breast reconstruction. Partial reconstruction essentially comprises of pedicle flaps like latissimus dorsi or a T-flap or other perforator-based flaps, and oncoplasty, where the breast size is adequate enough that allows you to remold the breast, the same breast, in a manner that is cosmetically pleasing. Whole breast reconstruction options are, again, various pedicle flaps are used, free flaps are the mainstay, and occasional cases we can use implants as well. So since we talk a lot these days about oncoplastic breast surgery, there are certain issues with it that we need to address. The first and foremost, as I've always been saying, is oncological safety. That should not be compromised, like margins, re-excisions, local recurrence rate should be as low as a regular breast conservation surgery, and mastectomy and survival should not be affected. Delivery of adjuvant therapy, which is equally essential for achieving the cure rate that we are achieved today in breast cancer. So there are complications of oncoplastic surgery. We need to make sure that we don't delay the adjuvant chemotherapy and radiation therapy. And cosmetic outcomes obviously will depend upon surgeon experience, training, choice of procedure, RT planning, etc. So do we have any evidence to say that it is oncologically safe, oncoplastic breast surgery? We don't, unfortunately, have a level one evidence here, and we probably don't need one, but we have enough level three and level two evidence of large retrospective and prospective series that when you choose the patient appropriately for an oncoplastic procedure, it should not affect the survival. So this is a large series from a single institution like MD Anderson, which says that there's no difference in overall survival or recurrence-free survival. Then there is a lot more published. This is again about oncoplastic breast surgery, a review article which tells us that there is no difference in margin involvement and there is no difference in local recurrence as well as metastasis rate. Are you able to hear me? Is somebody trying to call me from there? Because I'm getting a missed call from Bangladesh. You are able to hear me, right?
We missed 1 or 2 minutes to power interruption. Now we can hear you.
Okay, so do you want me to go back to a few slides?
Just one slide.
Okay, was I here the last you caught up with me?
Before it. One slide before. From here.
Okay. From here. Must be some interruption in the transmission. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, we can.
All right. All right. So I was essentially trying to say that the oncoplastic surgery has issues and we need to be aware of them so as to not, hamper our outcome. So oncological safety being the foremost, and delivery of adjuvant systemic therapy, starting chemotherapy and adjuvant radiation on time, is the second one. The cosmetic outcomes will then will improve with learning curve, and they depend on surgeon experience, appropriate training, a choice of procedure, etc. So unfortunately, we don't have high level evidence to say that this is acceptable. The majority of breast surgery has really evolved on high level evidence like BRCT versus mastectomy or mastectomy versus radical mastectomy. We probably don't even need such evidence for oncoplastic surgery. There are enough retrospective and prospective large series from all over the world which are published which say that oncoplastic breast surgery is safe today. This is a single institution experience from MD Anderson where they showed no difference in overall survival or recurrence-free survival when comparing conventional breast conservation surgery and that done with reconstruction or oncoplasty. A review article also looks at 5 studies published, and there was no difference in margin involvement, no difference in local recurrence or metastasis. Of course, this is after careful selection of patients, which we'll try and go through in the next few slides. Again, Milan, where the initial first few oncoplastic surgical procedures happened, single institutional study, match cohort analysis, recently published, and they found that there was no difference in the outcomes, overall survival, as well as margin positivity, as well as local recurrence. So Krishna Close paper, one of the pioneers of oncoplastic surgery from France, and again, 350 procedures done, published in 2018 at a median follow-up of 55 months. There was no really difference in local recurrence, or there was no higher complication as one would have expected, and there was no delay in starting adjuvant. So the aims or essentials of oncoplastic surgery include to prevent a deformity before forming one deformity. So that avoids unpredictable shrinkage post-radiation and post-breast surgery, breast conservation surgery. You try to hide your scars as much as possible, although it may not always be possible in a developing country setting like ours and maybe even at Bangladesh. But we do try to preserve breast shape, size, contour, form, symmetry, and feel. And you correct any pre-existing asymmetries if they're already there and if possible. And you try to enhance breast appearance. The most important things are shape, size, nipple position, contour, and symmetry. So in the Indian context, we need to, and maybe true for even Bangladesh, is that we need to take this all with a pinch of salt. I do agree our women are younger, so they may want or desire breast conservation surgery more. We don't have screen-detected tumors. We don't have population-based screening programs. So these are larger tumors. A lot of them are locally advanced, almost up to 30%. Often skin resections are unavoidable. And there is, we see a huge reluctance in contralateral procedures in our country. And patient expectations are far different than what you would have from the Western world. So choice of procedure really is individualized, depends upon tumor quadrant, breast size, breast to tumor ratio, the degree of ptosis, how's the contralateral breast, how's the symmetry, what donor sites are available to us, and what are the personal and cultural preferences really. So I would say the absolute indication for doing an oncoplastic surgery today would be an inner, central, and lower quadrant tumor of the breast with a poor breast to tumor ratio. Anything that is requiring more than 20% volume resection of the breast, large ptotic breast, multifocal tumors who are still desirous of breast conservation, and tumors who have had a poor response to neoadjuvant chemotherapy. A contraindication would be persistent positive margin, diffuse microcalcifications, multicentricity, inflammatory breast cancer, and previous radiation. These are contraindications for any breast conservation surgery, to be honest. So we need to understand the blood supply of the breast very well to be able to do the oncoplastic breast surgery, since fat necrosis incidence is quite high if the vascularity is not appropriately preserved. The options we have are volume displacement options, like the level one options, which could be disc rotation, rotation flaps, small advancement flaps, battering mastopexy, and other mastopexy principles. A level two procedure, like a reduction mammoplasty based procedure, which where you could actually use robust vascular pedicles of the breast. Volume replacement procedure, where you would need a local transposition flap, an advancement flap, a perforator flap, chest wall from the chest wall, or a pedicle flap like latissimus dorsi tram. And a level four procedure, like a free tissue transfer or a free flap. For me, essentially, I divide basics of all level one and two oncoplasties as a transposition, rotation, or an advancement flap. I think most of the procedures can be grouped, can be clubbed into these three groups. This is a commonly done thing, which is pillar mobilization and type 1 closure. You do this when the BT ratio is suitable. Tumor location allows for primary closure of cavity without puckering the skin, and we can have better incision planning to allow for minimal nipple displacement. These are few of the cases where just a pillar mobilization and type 1 closure was done, and you could, of course, you have scars on the breast because we still like to excise the skin overlying the tumor. But you have reasonably well-preserved shape, size, and symmetry. This is 1 year post-radiation result, and the patient had just one scar in the breast and one in the axilla, and she's quite happy. You have many such patients where just a type 1 procedure done, and the patients are happy, and they don't really realize that some breast procedure has been done. You sometimes may require a slight nipple repositioning procedure if the nipple is getting puckered, and you get good results with that as well. As I said, scars really cannot be avoided. Maybe we'll get to a stage where we really have smaller tumors like the breast, and we would be able to avoid scars on the breast, or we could hide them in a manner that they're not very visible. So this is one flap that we kind of described. It is already described in the literature, but we use it now routinely for outer quadrant breast defects where you have adequate lateral chest wall tissue and you're going to make a breast defect which needs a replacement. You could mobilize the lateral wall chest tissue and get into the breast, and it leads to a reasonably good cosmesis, and you can avoid doing an LD flap, which can be then kept for future use, and patients are quite happy. Even skin can be replaced, like how you would need in an LD flap would offer you to replace skin. This can be done. And this allows you to even resect larger multifocal tumors mainly in the outer, central, upper outer, and lower outer quadrants. And we have reasonably good results with that. And the vascularity of the flap is based on mainly the dermal subdermal plexus, and it's quite robust. We managed to get this published this year in JAPRAS, and this was a series of 40 patients. Rotation flaps for inner quadrant defects are also quite commonly done, where you can use the inframammary fold to extend your incision from the breast and rotate some tissue into the defect, and with cheating allow primary closure, and leads to a reasonably acceptable cosmesis. This is mainly for the lower inner quadrant tumors. You could have a lower central quadrant deformity, which is really unacceptable today, which leads to bird's beaking. You could do a triangular wedge resection and a vice pattern closure for a lower central defect. You can take care of a small defect as well as a slightly larger defect with this kind of a closure. You could do an inferior pedicle dermoglandular advancement, which is a reduction-based procedure, and you could take care of central quadrant or upper central quadrant tumors. Especially our women who are not willing for a contralateral procedure are sometimes accepting of a mild asymmetry, but they want breast conservation. This one patient I particularly remember who wanted a breast conservation, needed a central quadrant BCT because of skin puckering and retroareolar presence of tumor. And she refused a contralateral procedure. And 1 year later, she came back to me and said that I want to reduce my other breast also. And we did a right reduction and symmetrization procedure 18 months after the initial procedure. Some patients are willing for bilateral procedures, so we end up doing unilateral BCT and oncoplasty and a contralateral procedure and reduce a large totic breast and to make a smaller breast, which is symmetrical and more acceptable to the patient. In some cases, you need to take help from your plastic surgery colleagues and even do some extreme oncoplastic procedures and still try to achieve reasonable cosmesis in those patients who are willing for it or who want it. LD flap, of course, is available. It is a workhorse of breast reconstruction, especially when we have larger resections and no available tissue anywhere else. It can very well lead to good cosmetic outcomes in partial breast defects. These are a few examples where LD flap can be used even for extended indications for whole breast reconstruction. And we have good cosmesis 1 year post-treatment. The patient actually wants to augment her other breast. So for me, I divide oncoplasty as those patients. First, you look at whether the patient is amenable to breast conservation surgery. And the second thing you look at is what is the volume of the breast and what is the degree of ptosis. If the breast is large and totic, you go for a reduction-based procedure. If the breast is totic but not really large, you get a mastopexy-based procedure, which is essentially the same as a reduction. If the breast is moderate and non-totic, then you go for a local flap or a round block principal surgery or some J-plasty and rotation flap. And if the breast is breast is small and non-totic, then you need to get some volume replacement. You need to get a perforaceous base flap or a latissimus dorsi flap. All this is fraught with complications, and we do have our share of complications that we see. A systematic review published of oncoplastic procedures says that you have around 3.3% rate of fat necrosis, and up to 5% rate of complication is probably acceptable. A series from MD Anderson, again, a single institution experience of large series comparing oncoplasty complication rate with those of routine breast conservation surgery complication rate. And they really found that there was not much difference. Rather, the oncoplastic procedures had a lower chance of seroma than the routine breast conservation. So another problem that could happen with oncoplastic surgery is potential delay in delivery of adjuvant therapy. And we know that radiation needs to start within 8 weeks and chemotherapy needs to start within 3 months following surgery. And if you're not able to achieve adequate delivery of chemotherapy and radiation, we are looking at a decrease in detriment in survival, which could be as much as 4 to 8%. If you look at published literature, whether oncoplastic surgery is really delaying adjuvant chemotherapy or not, it probably is not, because we are being more vigilant and we are careful in starting adjuvant treatment on time. There are radiation therapy issues that we are all aware of, where boost is essentially important for local control. And we know that delivery of adequate boost is required. The difficulties in oncoplastic surgery are the skin incisions are not where the lumpectomy cavity is. There is really no seroma because the cavity is approximated. Volume displacement procedures also rotate glandular breast tissue and fill the lumpectomy cavity. And there is a movement of cavity walls away from the posterior bed. Because of that, it becomes more difficult to identify tumor bed for boost in these patients. And my colleague, Dr. Tabassum, would agree with me that sometimes for us, it is a nightmare to plan a boost in these patients, because they come 4 to 5 months after surgery. And we really document very well with our surgical notes what we have done so that our memory doesn't fail us. Nowadays, we know surgical scar or boost based on a seroma is obsolete. Surgical clips are essential. And CT simulation is done, or planning is done based on CT scan. And some people are even using 3D markers of certain absorbable materials in the place of clips, but this is not yet cost effective for us in India. So our mainstay is putting surgical clips appropriately to delineate the lumpectomy cavity and to do a CT scan based planning. So often when we move tissue from one place to another, we try to put clips in the tumor bed as well as the walls. And this has been shown to be effective in improving radiation therapy boost planning after oncoplastic surgery. There are multiple published papers who say that clip placement, if it is done appropriately, boost delivery is possible. And this is a few of the slides from my colleague, Dr. Tabassum, who is running a study regarding appropriate boost planning in oncoplasty patients. And she takes utmost care and converses with us quite often. We go down to the radiation department and help them in planning the boost area so the patient gets a proper boost delivery. This is easier in a type 1 procedure, but it may be slightly more difficult in a type 2 oncoplasty or a reduction-based procedure. But with appropriate planning, we can achieve a proper boost delivery. Rather, I think she would talk much more about it. But if you plan appropriately, then the boost volume can actually go down instead of irradiating the entire flap. So we may overestimate the tumor bed volume if we are not careful while boost planning. So one thing I would like to say is that oncoplastic breast surgery has improved cosmetic outcomes in breast surgery. I really like this published paper by MJ Silverstein, who said that the swell is building, the wave is coming. It will break on your shore. Get aboard and get on the wave, or the wave will sweep you off your feet. But however, we need to keep in mind that to a man with a hammer, everything looks like a nail. So we should be using these procedures sparingly. And even in Tata Memorial Hospital, 50% of our breast conservations are still conventional breast conservation surgeries with just approximation of cavity or a type 1 procedure. And we do a type 2 procedure only when it's really indicated or if really required in a patient who's well motivated, who's going to take radiation at a good center, so that people understand the nuances in planning treatment after oncoplastic breast surgery. We do have options for whole breast reconstruction for patients who cannot have breast conservation for tumor-related reasons. And mainly, they are autologous reconstruction using the patient's own tissue or microvascular-free flaps like a TRAM, LD, or a DF. And implant-based are very rarely used in India, or very rarely used by us at Tata Memorial. We have a very strong and good microvascular team who's able to reconstruct majority of skin as well as volume defects of the breast. and a lot of patients are happy. So coming to a few more advances, like what we do new today is the use of ICG fluorescence imaging in breast surgery. And it's indocyanine green is the dye that is used, and you have a handheld laser light device that will excite the light and you will catch the color on your screen. So multiple studies have looked at the use of indocyanine green in sentinel lymph node biopsies in breast cancer patients, and they have shown ICG to be quite reliable with a very low false negative rate. This study says it's 0%, but a lot of studies say it's less than 5%. And we can use ICG along with the blue dye for sentinel node procedures as a dual tracer technique, especially useful maybe even in your country and ours, where radiocolloid dyes are nuclear medicine departments are not routinely available. So again, this is a review article which looks at diagnostic performance of indocyanine green guided sentinel lymph node biopsy in breast cancer, and they have shown 92% sensitivity and 100% specificity. This is what the we have. We have a FluOptics instrument with us now, ICG instrument with a software and computer. We use Oro Green as the dye as the injection at a recommended dose of 0.1 to 0.5 milligram per kg body weight. And we still use a lot of low axillary sampling procedures because we have already validated that study that you saw with Dr. Garvit. However, we can use dual tracer sentinel node technique, and we are currently running a study of comparison of lower axillary sampling with sentinel tracer, dual tracer sentinel node biopsy procedures. This is one of the cases I have operated where you can see that bright node on the machine with the indocyanine green dye, and it's the same node that you anatomically see down. You can then send it for frozen section and carry out your sentinel node biopsy procedure. The dye can also be used for reverse axillary mapping lymphangiography to avoid lymphedema. Again, this technique has not really been foolproof, and there are a lot of published literature available on this. We don't use this routinely, but we are trying to do a study where we are trying to understand that if we require a complete axillary lymph node dissection, then how could we spare the reverse axillary nodes and prevent the risk of or reduce the risk of lymphedema. Again, mastectomy flaps, it's very useful to study their perfusion along with the ICG. They are precarious, they are random pattern, and they depend on really subdermal plexus. So clinical assessment is always there. You can look at the color, the edge of the dermal bleeding, capillary refill, etc. But newer techniques like ICG dye can also help you in predicting mastectomy skin flap necrosis. This is more true in skin sparing mastectomies where you are going to use implants and autologous reconstruction procedures where you would like to know beforehand if the skin is going to survive or not. And they say that you can predict this very well with indocyanine green dye. And if you have skin perfusion more than 40 to 45%, then the skin is likely to be viable. So multiple retrospective studies available, which is again shown the cutoff of 40 to 45% is a sensitive cutoff for identifying flap necrosis. This is something that we have done, a subcutaneous mastectomy, and that's our flow ICG uptake pattern in the skin, and the patient didn't have a complication. So other thing that I would say is new in breast cancer is management of non-palpable lesions. Fortunately, in country like ours and yours also, we don't screen routinely population-based. So we don't have this high incidence of non-palpable lesions where we need to do something. So we still use hook wire localization as the traditional method for biopsying non-palpable lesion or an ultrasound guided biopsy. However, there are multiple other techniques available today like radioactive seed, non-radioactive radar localization, magnetic seed localization, radio frequency identification, etc. I do not have personal experience with any of these, but a lot of these are being used in the UK and we have a lot of published literature now. As you already saw, that sentinel node biopsy is an acceptable procedure in axillary node negative axilla, early breast cancer. It reduces the risk of lymphedema, sensory deficits, and there is a better shoulder dysfunction. A lot of studies, again, I saw a lot of questions also being asked about what one would do if axilla is node positive. Aquasog Z11 and IBCSG23-1 has already published the data. Multiple other studies are currently running to see the utility of leaving behind axilla in node positive patients. But of course, in a non-inferiority setting and in carefully selected setting, not really valid for India. And I understood somebody asked the question about this level 3 axilla. And as Garvit also mentioned, this paper, we published this in 2019, where we looked at 1600 patients who were node positive. And when four or more level nodes were lower level nodes were involved, there was a 54% chance of having a level 3 involvement. So we do advocate up to level 3 axillary dissection if the nodes are positive, but an NCCN recommends up to level 2. So I would say a minimum of level 2 and up to level 3 dissection should be carried out if multiple nodes are involved in the lower axilla. Again, regarding what do we do if axilla is positive? If axilla is positive, we still go ahead with a complete axillary clearance. I think ECOSOC Z11 and IBCSG 23-1 findings are not applicable routinely in our patients. We do have a higher nodal burden. We have a larger tumor size. We do not deal with screen-detected tumors. We deal with palpable tumors which the patient has a complaint of the tumor. So when we looked at retrospectively, my colleagues, Dr. Asha and Dr. Neeta Nair looked at this retrospectively, that when we had 1 to 2 lymph nodes positive, there was a 30% chance of having additional nodal positivity in these patients. So as of now, we cannot really advocate this routinely in our setting. Again, post-chemotherapy axillary conservation, 3 studies are already published, the ECOSOC Z1071, Sentina and Sentinel Node FNSE study, which says that the identification rates with in the post-chemotherapy setting of a sentinel node are lower than what would be in the upfront setting. So the rates are anywhere between 80 to 92%, and the false negative rate is also more than 10%. If as per NSAP B32, a false negative rate of 10% or less is required for leaving behind the axilla, then we haven't yet achieved less than 10% false negative rate in the post-chemotherapy setting. However, we recently published this study about post-chemotherapy low axillary sampling in the Journal of Global Oncology. We completed this study between 2012 and 18 of 750 patients where we did low axillary sampling and found the false negative rate to be actually less than 10%, which was not achieved by the sentinel node studies. So another, I saw somebody asking about targeted axillary dissection. That's a new kid on the block. Since we know that the false negative rate of post-chemotherapy sentinel node procedure is more than 10%, how could we drop this further to get it acceptable and less than 5 to 10%? So one, you could put a clip in the axilla that would make the false negative rate 6.8%. There are radioactive iodine seeds which are placed in some countries, and that would also drop the false negative rate. There are magnetic seed placement studies available now where that would also reduce your false negative rate. And interestingly, these studies also showed that 25% of the clip node was actually not the set. 25% of the times, the clip node was not the sentinel node. So it tells you that you need to do something more than a sentinel lymph node biopsy, whether it's a low axillary sampling procedure, which is slightly more than a sentinel node biopsy, or whether you are in an affluent country and you can afford to put clips in the axillary nodes, multiple of them, or even a magnetic seed, then one may go ahead with that. However, we do not have any level one evidence to say that this would be acceptable and would not hamper long-term disease-free survival outcome. So there should be some study underway with respect to this with long-term survival as a primary endpoint and not just false negative rate. So I would say that breast cancer surgery is a rapidly evolving and dynamic field. We have seen a real shift from radicality to conservatism without any compromise on long-term outcomes, with optimizing cosmesis and trying to improve the quality of life. Thank you very much to organizers again to have me here for this talk. I miss being there in Dhaka. I was there in 2017 and I really enjoyed their hospitality there. But I think this is what we do when there is a pandemic going on. So thank you very much again. Thank you.